This is Children's Hour coming to you from AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. With you in mind, we have programs such as Bible verses, recitals, story time, singing, and many, many more just for you. Stay tuned.
I am 9 years old. My memory verse is taken from Psalm 37. Psalm 37. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
My name is Lodina Ojo. I am 9 years old. My memory verse is taken from Isaiah chapter 45, verse 18 to 19. For thus says the Lord, who created the heavens, who is God, who formed the earth and made it, who has established it, who did not create it in vain, who formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is no other God. I have not spoken in secret, in a dark place of the earth. I did not say to the seed of Jacob, seek me in vain. I, the Lord, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right. Amen.
My name is Brady Sewa Bonsu. I am 10 years old. My memory verse is taken from 1 John chapter 9 verse 1. 1 John chapter 9 verse 1. If you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Thank you.
My name is Abishak Abuajiwa Amea. I am 9 years old. My memory verse is taken from John 3:16 in German. Then also how God that will go back, dam es and elbon, song up ef dam e, die and go bed, net volun wadin, die wegleben haben, amen. And in English, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life, amen.
My name is Kofi 19. I am 7 years old. My memory verse is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 15 to 18. With joy always, pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Amen.
My name is Angela Collins. I am 7 years old. My memory verse is taken from Galatians 2 verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Amen.
My name is Natalia Jenny Boateng. I am 11 years old. My memory verse is taken from Psalm 119 verse 1 and 2. Blessed are those whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the word of the Lord. Amen.
My name is Lesson Alboka. I am 7 years old. My memory verse is taken from Acts 4:31. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke of the word of God boldly. Amen.
Wonderful children of God, we thank God for our lives and the opportunity to listen to his counsels. This is Storyline with Sylvia Edubuahin, and the story of Moses still continues. Today's story is about frogs, flies, and hail, and can be found in Exodus chapters 7 to 10. Exodus chapters 7 to 10. Let's pray. We come before you once again, dear Father. Please see us through this lesson in Jesus' name. Amen. God had promised Moses that he would do many terrifying things to make the king and the people of Israel to understand that he was able to rescue his people. Moses and Aaron went back to the king and warned him that if he did not obey God and set free his people, all kinds of misfortunes would come to Egypt. But the king simply laughed and refused to pay any attention. God kept his promise, and 9 terrible disasters struck Egypt, all at God's command. After each one, Moses went to the king and gave him the chance to change his mind and obey God. But every time the king hardened his heart, first, Moses raised his stick on God's orders, and the life-giving water of the River Nile, which supplied all Egypt, changed to thick, red, oozing liquid. Then frogs came jumping out of the foul waters and hopped everywhere, into the houses, the beds, and the ovens. At first, the court magicians copied Moses, showing what wonderful tricks they could perform. But they could do nothing to cleanse the Nile water or get rid of the frogs. The king was sorry for himself. He promised Moses that he would let the people go if their God would only take away the frogs. Moses prayed to God, and the frogs died. But the moment the trouble was over, the king changed his mind again and said no to Moses and to God. Then God sent stinging, winging gnats and fat buzzing flies. Each time, the king promised Moses that if God took away the plague, he would let the people go. Each time, Moses listened to the king, and each time, the king changed his mind once the disaster was over and refused to let the Israelites go. Cows, horses, and donkeys died from disease, and the people themselves broke out in painful, red, swelling boils. But still, the king said no. A storm broke, and huge hailstones rained down like bullets. But still, the king said no. A plague of hungry locusts came like a black cloud and devoured all the crops. After that, the land was plunged for 3 days into black, inky darkness. In Goshen, the people of Israel were kept safe from these troubles. God had proved that he was stronger and greater than all the gods of Egypt and their clever magicians. But still, the king said no. What a stubborn king. After each disaster that befell the country and people of Egypt, Moses and Aaron went to see the king. They begged him to change his mind and listen to God. But he refused to obey, and so save his people from yet more trouble. After God had sent the ninth sign, total darkness for 3 long days, the king flew into rage. "Get out of my sight," he shouted at Moses. "I never want to set eyes on you again." "You won't," Moses told him. "But because you will not change your mind, God must do one more terrible thing. After that, you will let his people go." God says, "At midnight, I shall go through the whole land of Egypt, and the firstborn son in every family will die, from the palace to the poorest hovel. There will be great crying and mourning in all Egypt." But the obstinate king still paid no attention to Moses or to God's warning. God told Moses that the Israelite people were to be kept safe from this last and worst disaster, just as they had been from the others. But this time, they must follow God's instructions, which Moses gave to them. If every family did as God said, the eldest son would be saved when the angel of death went through the land. Thank you so much once again for today. My name is Aunt Sylvia. I'll come your way again next time. Bye.
To contact us, write to Adventist World Radio, Ghana, Valley University, P.O. Box, AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana. Or call us on +233-244-673528 or +233-208-704-532 or email us at radio@vvu.edu.gh.
Words of He's waiting and watching, watching for you.
Hello, my dear little children, boys and girls. Am I not glad that you are here to listen to your uncle once again? So we continue to think about the serious questions. Serious questions from little Hass. So she said, God, where do you live? I said, wow, no one has been to heaven before. Oh, you heard heaven. You bow down your heads. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, as we want to think about where you live, please bless us and help us to understand. Please let us see pictures of heaven, even as we listen and when we sleep at night. Help us to dream about heaven, because we are told heaven is a very beautiful place. Thank you, dear Jesus, for being such a nice, lovely friend for us. Amen. Where do you think God lives? You know, when I asked my little girls about this question, they pointed, you know, upwards. Well, then another girl, you know, standing by said, okay, uncle, you know what? Teacher tells us that the world is round. So if the world is round and God lives in heaven, I point here, what about those who live, you know, below where we live, since it is round and we are living on the surface of the earth? Let's say it is like a ball and I am living somewhere here, somewhere, you know, on the circumference. Somebody will also be living down there. Somebody will be up there. So when we point to heaven, where are we pointing to? Where is heaven? That is a tough question. I said, why will my niece ask me such a tough question? I think we had better ask the astronauts, you know, at the American Space Station, questions such as this. I've never been to space before. Well, but questions about God, you want to go to the Bible, isn't it? In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 2, Paul relays a very interesting experience. Paul says he knew a man in Christ who was about 14 years ago, whether in the body, he said he was caught up to heaven. And then he said he knew such a man. Then he said he was caught up to the third heavens. Wow. So there is heaven number one, heaven number two, and heaven number three. Well, that is where God lives. God lives in the heavens. But how far away are the heavens? To try to explain this to you would be, you know, making an attempt to explain the internet to an ant. To be difficult, don't you think so? Just look at the tiny ant explaining to the ant how wonderful, how wide, how vast, how deep the internet is. To be too difficult a thing for the ant to understand. Well, that is how it is. But the Bible has given us certain glimpses of heaven. One, we know that in heaven, that is where God lives. So the heaven is the center, the headquarters of the universe. But how pretty, how does heaven look like? There are serious, you know, things that the Bible says about heaven, you know. John the Revelator, the gentleman we spoke of the other time, he says that the streets of heaven, what are they made of? Who knows? Well, you better tell uncle about it, or tell mommy, if you really know. They said the heavens, the streets in heavens, they are made of pure gold. Wow! If the streets where we will be walking, that is made of gold, then you would want to wonder, what will the walls be made, you know, of? Diamonds, emerald, other precious stones? I think you are right. Heaven is a very serious place. Let me tell you one other thing about heaven. The Bible says there is sea in heaven. And that sea, it is called the crystal sea, the sea of glass. Can you imagine that? So you would imagine that in heaven, you wouldn't need to buy a mirror. No, you don't need to. Since the sea is a sea of glass, when you want to dress, just take your things, go to the seashore, and you will see yourself pretty clear in it. It is a sea of glass. There's another interesting thing in heaven that you want to know. Well, in heaven, there aren't restaurants. There aren't chop bars. That woman who sells food, you know, under the tree in school, you wouldn't see food vendors in heaven. In heaven, there is the tree of life. And the Bible tells us that the tree of life, we will be going there to eat once every month. And in the once every month, it will give all kinds of tastes. And people everywhere will come and eat of that tree. Every taste, every good taste that we know, that tree will give us. Well, you may wonder, which is the electricity company in heaven? Have you thought of it? Well, in heaven, the people who work in the electricity company, they wouldn't have jobs in heaven. You know why? The Bible says that the face of God shines so bright, there is no night night there. In heaven, there is no night there. We can play and play and play and run and run and run. We will know no tiredness. If we will run to play football, I am sure we can play and play and play. Whatever you love doing. You know, on earth, there are just 12 hours during the day. In heaven, the hours are endless. The Bible says one day before God is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. Wow! So how will the 1 month be measured? Well, God knows. I believe there will be some kind of wonderful clock in heaven that shows us as the days, you know, roll by. But it is interesting. The Bible says there will be so much to see. We're going to see Grandpa Abraham. We will see Moses. We will see Adam. We will see Eve. We will see Abel. We will see Seth. We will see all those wonderful people. I tell you, if you don't go to heaven, it will be the greatest loss. If there is anything we need to give up in order to go to heaven, let us do it right now. You know the other serious thing? The people who are issuing visas for people to fly to heaven, they are doing it right now. And bad guys and bad girls aren't going there. I will tell you next time about the dress code in heaven. It's interesting. But would Jesus allow us, such naughty boys and girls like us, to go to heaven? Well, in John chapter 14, verse 1 to 3, the Bible says, you know, Christ told them that he would soon be leaving, and they were sad. Then he said, don't you be sad. You know what? Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many rooms. If that were not true, I would have told you, you know, I'm going to prepare a good place for you. And after I have gone and prepared the place for you, I will come for you and I will take you to where I am, so that where I am, there you also may be. Is that not beautiful? In heaven, I will tell you, there are more beautiful things about heaven. I am excited about heaven, and I know you are excited about heaven. Prepare to go to heaven. Do everything possible. Be the best you can, because yes, we may be naughty now. Christ is not cross with us. He's not angry, but we will not take this naughty behavior to heaven. So when we are asked to be nice people, let us be nice people. The Lord bless you. I love you, my niece. I love you, my nephew. God bless you as you begin dreaming about heaven. Shall we have a word of prayer? Dear Jesus, we want to be in this beautiful heaven. You have not told us about the aircraft that will take us to heaven. But please, whatever that aircraft will be, help us to make it so that when you welcome your people, we'll be one of them. Bless us. Thank you for being our friend. Thank you for preparing heaven for us. In your name have we prayed with thanksgiving. Amen.
To contact us, write to Adventist World Radio, Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box, AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana. Or call us on +233-244-673528 or +233-208-704-532 or email us at radio@vvu.edu.gh. Thank you very much for staying with us. Once again, to contact us, write to Adventist World Radio, Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box, AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, or call us on +233-307-051-058 or +233-208-704-532 or email us at radio@vvu.edu.gh.